Jamie, and thank you all. Thank you, Paulo, for the invitation. I'm going to try to summarize in 12 minutes or so my paper, which is part of a larger project on intellectuals in the Velasco government. As you, most of you know, 6 days after the coup in on October 9th, 1968, the military government nationalized the oil industry, in my hometown, Talara. Velasco gave a speech, and he said, among other things, the revolutionary government, raising the flag of the new emancipation, now and forever, puts in the lips of every Peruvian the vibrant expression of our national anthem, Somos libres, seamos lo siempre. One of the key rhetorical devices that the new government put into place was precisely that of representing the new or second emancipation or independence. Official discourse emphasized that the military government was realizing Peru's second independence, the first one obviously being the one proclaimed in 1821. The proxximity of the sesquicentennial commemoration of that independence gave the government an opportunity to both showcase its accomplishments and claim political and historical legitimacy by establishing this direct and explicit connection between the events that culminated in the proclamation of independence in 1821 and the process that started about 150 years earlier, I mean later. Shortly after, on September 16, 1969, the government created a commission, National Commission for the Sesquicentennial of Peruvian Independence, and then named General Juan Mendoza Rodriguez as president, appointed 17 other members, including several prominent conservative historians who represented various institutions, such as Instituto Ribagüero, La Academia Nacional de la Historia, La Biblioteca Nacional, El Instituto San Martín, and so forth. This was a surprising decision, of course. You know, a government that claimed to be revolutionary names a commission formed by mostly conservative historians. Aurelio Miró Quesada, the director of El Comercio, José Agustín de la Puente y Candamo, Félix de Negri Luna, Armando Nieto Vélez, and others. There were also advisors that included some people that had a different, a little bit more critical view of Peruvian history, including Jorge Basadre, Luis Valcárcel, and Emilio Romero, among others, but this played a lesser role in the commemoration of independence. The single most important and expensive project was, as many of you know, the compilation and publication of the Colección Documental de la Independencia del Perú, this huge collection of documents originally planned to include 106 volumes, of which 86 were actually published. Besides that, and you know, there is a memoir written by Mendoza in 1974, and there's a long list of everything they did, including, you know, the budget and so forth. So I, you know, the longer version of the paper will include a lot more information on specific events. But basically, 18 monuments were built, 25 busts, 125 memorial plaques, 13 paintings, and so forth. There were contests of, you know, music and dance and monographs, etc., etc. There were also civic rituals, parades, virtually in every town. The commission itself organized 40 of those events. 21 were defined as cultural, 13 as civic, and only 6 as social. This was not a program of festivities, proudly proclaimed, reported General Mendoza in the memoir he wrote. On July 28, 1971, the day of the sesquicentennial, Velasco gave the central speech from the governmental palace. This is Velasco addressing the nation on that day. You can quickly see that Francisco Pizarro is actually behind him. This is a, kind of an ironic moment. Later, Pizarro will be removed and Tupac Amaru will be, but too late for the photo of the sesquicentennial of independence. So the celebration was a lot more sober than, for instance, the celebration of the centennial anniversary that took place in 1921 during the Leguía administration. no sort of carnivalesque celebrations here in 1971. No sort of luxurious cocktails and public sort of parties as it happened in 1921. Part of this has to do with the tone that the commission adopted from the very beginning, much more academic and certainly much more political. It also had to do with the earthquake that had affected the central part of the Andes in Huaraz and elsewhere in 1970. The government was spending some money trying to, in the reconstruction efforts and so forth. So there was this sort of restrained attitude during the celebration. In my paper, I discuss what we could call the official approach to Peruvian independence put forward during this months and years. And here I put Velasco and a few other people on one side and then the commission itself on the other one. And if you follow Velasco's speeches during all this period, there's a clear message. The independence proclaimed in 1821 was incomplete, truncated. It didn't actually bring what it promised to bring. And so the poor continued to be poor. The nation continued to be spoiled by, the foreign domination and so forth. But also, the second sort of rhetorical image that Velasco kept bringing up was that his regime was going to complete the first independence. So it was both the notion that the first one was a failure, but also that it was a precedent for what Velasco was trying to accomplish. For instance, he said at a speech at the Sociedad Fundadora de la Independencia, he stated that the revolution emerged as a logic consequence of the legacy of the heroes of independence, the próceres, a legacy that did not die but continued to live in the people's soul. The revolution seeks, in fact, to fulfill the dream of the promoters of our independence. So it's a very interesting, tricky kind of series of statements in that it implies a critique of the first independence, but also the claim that they are following on the steps of that dream that was not realized then and now they were going to complete. There are many other quotations that I'm going to skip and show you this. This came inside a book that the government published to justify it. I think the title of the book is ¿Por qué el 3 de octubre? And then inside that book, there's this image. And you can see clearly it's 28 de julio, somos libres. And then the second part, seamoslo siempre, attached to the October 3rd, 1968. It's like, that's what we are here to do, to make sure we're free forever. And then, of course, the soldier and somebody that looks like a peasant or somebody with, rural background, together breaking the chains, et cetera, et cetera. Now, the commission had a slightly different approach. And I'm going to read quickly. The overall message that came across the 86 volumes of the Colección Documental, the monuments and other forms of memorializing, the civic rituals and so forth, was one of national unity and widespread and protracted participation of all Peruvians in the independence process. In a lecture about the participation of the people in the independence in the early 19th century, De La Puente y Candamo reiterated the idea that the proclamation of independence represented the free outcome of the Peruvians' personal attitude. It was a slow process, he added, a free effort of the Peruvian man. An article in El Comercio offered a kind of a nice summary of this vision. Men of lineage and common men, clergymen and free thinkers, wealthy men and poor men, civilian and military, all of them came together not to choose but to insist on the path towards a free fatherland, which was already envisioned centuries earlier by the first representatives of the Nacionalidad Peruana. So there are different emphases in the vision of independence as articulated by Velasco and some of his closest collaborators and the commission. But in my paper, I emphasize the points of agreement or convergence. I think the apparent paradox of a revolutionary government appointing a commission comprised mostly of conservative historians can be understood if we look at these points of convergence between these two visions. And I want to mention four of those elements of convergence. First, both the military government and the traditional conservative historians share a defense of the sacred institutions of the fatherland, particularly in the context of the Cold War and vis-a-vis serious threats against the armies in various countries in Latin America. The Peruvian experiment, as it was called, despite its revolutionary rhetoric and its sometimes radical reforms, could also be interpreted, as you know, and many people have said this, as a project to actually defend the fatherland against communism. That is, could be interpreted as a kind of preventive revolution. Let's do it us, instead of, you know, the radical, the Maoist, you know, the Guevarista guerrillas and so forth. Second, a discourse of national unity before and during the first independence that was put forward by these conservative historians was not incompatible with the notion of an incomplete and truncated process as highlighted by Velasco and the military leaders. In fact, these unifying nationalistic discourse worked better for the military than the alternative Marxist or radical interpretation that Bonilla and Spalding and others would eventually put forward. This one, Bonilla Spalding, in their very well-known critique of the nationalist view of independence, in fact undermined both the nationalistic thesis of independence and the claims for national unity that the military were promoting to legitimize the rule, the slogan, Pueblo y Fuerza Armada, Unidos Venceremos, as you probably remember. A strong attachment to nationalism as a central component in the definition of Peruvian identity, past and present, united both the historians and the military interpretations of independence, even if, when it came to present-day policies, land reform, nationalizations, etc., they rather took different path on that. The third element is the thesis about the popular participation in the first independence that was central to this unifying view of national independence shared by conservative historians, also served very well the rhetoric of the military government in 1971 and beyond. If the people could do it then, they could do it again. And then even in the choosing of words, as you know, the Velasco regime defined itself as a project to create democracia social de participación plena. The word participación was very prominent in the rhetoric of the government. And, you know, in the works of Ella Dunbar Temple and others, they were also talking about la participación popular en la independencia in 1821. And finally, and I won't have time to get to the conclusions, but the fourth moment or element of convergence was Tupac Amaru, which facilitated but also complicated this relationship between the military and the conservative historians. And it's too bad that Chuck is not here, because his paper would have illuminated this better than what I can say here. But conservative historians didn't really embrace Tupac Amaru. They started doing research and publishing about Tupac Amaru, but he wasn't yet the kind of hero for this traditional view of independence. There was a growing interest in revolts, in guerrillas, montoneras, and so forth, and that's what led to this discussion of la participación popular en la independencia. But it was actually the Velasco government's embracing of Tupac Amaru that put his image and his legacy at the forefront. So it was politics, not historiography, what helped bring Tupac Amaru to the forefront. And then shortly afterwards, we start seeing the works of Scarlett O'Fallon and Flores Galindo and later others, including Chuck Walker himself. As you, I'm sure, know, the slogan for the I think Stefano mentioned that yesterday, el patrón ya no comerá más de tu pobreza was attributed to Tupac Amaru. It was a lie, of course. And I don't know if you read this in a recent book, but the author interviewed the person that came up with that slogan and said, where did you get that from? And he said, oral tradition. So this is exactly what they were meaning. Tupac Amaru promised, you know, land reform, etc., etc. Velasco fulfilled that promise. So there was this really close identification. And then, am I out of time? Let me just show you.
But you are.
Let me ask. I'll finish with this. These two emphases are also clear in the two supplements that were published for the sesquicentennial commemoration. One by El Comercio, one by El Peruano, the official newspaper. This is El Comercio, and as you can see, although Tupac Amaru appears like strong and big, it's José de San Martín who occupies the forefront. El Peruano published actually two parts, Primera Independencia and Segunda Independencia. In Primera Independencia, not San Martín, but Tupac Amaru. This is the famous logo that you all have seen, I'm sure, in posters, etc. So, anyway, I'll leave it there. I can read my conclusion.
So, I would like to first thank Paulo and the Institute for the Americas and Professor Philip at LSE for the invitation. It's a huge honor for me to be here. As you, those of you who read my paper might have seen, I perhaps overdid the contextualization part and the interpretative ideas were a little bit all over the place in the draft. So, and I had some trouble uniting the narrative, the context and the analysis. And so for this presentation, I'm going to go straight to the narrative part of it. I thought about justifying this in a more fancy way, invoking return to narrative, Lawrence Stone and whatnot, but I think it's just an easier way to present things in what I hope will be a more compelling way. And I'm gonna read, I don't trust my English that much, so forgive me for that. So, General Juan Velasco Alvarado, the former president of the Revolutionary Government of the Armed Forces, died at 8:10 in the morning of December 24, 1977, after years of struggling with disease since 1973, we can talk about that a little bit more later. And within minutes, hundreds of citizens gathered in front of the hospital. They waited there for hours until the chapel of the hospital opened, and they were allowed to join the first part of the wave. The doors of the chapel opened at 4:00, and by then there already was a large agglomeration outside. The Peruvian flag was flown at half-mast, and the crowd began to sing the national anthem, for the first time of many during that week. People waited in a big line, visitors entered the chapel, sought a coffin, crossed themselves, brought flowers, and gave their condolences to the family. The chapel remained open to visitors until midnight. Early in the following morning, the coffin that contained the dead body of Velasco was picked in a black army-owned car to be taken to El Sagrario, the side chapel next to the cathedral in Lima's main square. During the 5 kilometers that separated the hospital from the square, thousands greeted the car, which had been escorted by official motorcycles and some 20 vehicles that carried relatives and government officials. In the morning of the 25th, the newspapers were all about Velasco's passing. They hadn't had time to publish more than worrying news the previous morning, and at that point, the 25th, all journalists had to be aware of the impressive turnout the day before. During that day and the following one, they all reproduced with excruciating detail, and one would imagine that was because they were forced to do so in the ambiguous political climate of the period, the official protocol dictated by the military government of Morales Bermúdez at that time. From what time to what time the coffin could be visited, by whom, where, who would transport it, and here we were included representatives of popular organizations designated by the government, how they would transport it, which streets they would use, who was supposed to sit in each part of the cathedral, who would speak and when. There was no room for direct popular involvement in the government's program, and the coffin would be at all times guarded by military officials or under their strict supervision. The Ministry of the Interior, moreover, had a statement published in which it declared that it had acquired knowledge about the intentions of subversive elements that wanted to use the occasion to disrupt the public order and establish the established protocol. Security measures would be therefore redoubled, and any attempt to alter the public order would be quote-unquote severely punished. At the same time, however, the papers were enthusiastically reproducing and commenting on the calls for massive popular participation in the funerals. In particular, a statement issued by a dozen of mostly, but not only, left-wing political parties and unions, including the Communist and Socialist parties, with all their subdivisions, the CNA, the Aprista CNT, the CTRP, which is the government-backed union, among many other organizations, most of which had openly expressed their dislike to the ways of the second phase of the revolution. In the statement, the organization declared that the revolutionary people had a duty to participate in the funerals of Velasco, the only president that had ever done anything for them in the history of the Republic. In an explicit challenge to the government, the statement declared that the popular organization had decided that the coffin had to be carried to the cemetery in shoulders by the people, and that it was the people, and every time I say the people, you imagine, quote-unquote, would choose two representatives among their own to make a speech during the funeral. So when the coffin and the cortege arrived to the side chapel at 9:50 on the 26th, the turnout in the square consisted of just a few thousand people. More impressive was the police cordon that separated the crowd from the side chapel. And there was a little bit of attempts of the crowd to penetrate this police cordon that there wasn't enough people, so nothing happened there. But as soon as the casket, just gonna skip this. Inside the chapel, there was a mix of military and Catholic paraphernalia, floral arrangements, and funeral wreaths reached the atrium and beyond. A brief mass was performed, and then the chapel was opened. This time, the lines were 4 or 5 blocks long. They lasted all day. Blue-collar workers, peasants, children, and poor housewives from towns far away and from the shanty towns around Lima all paraded, some representing organizations and some in spontaneous reactions to the news. The side chapel remained open until 8 o'clock in the morning of the 27th. So when the police arrived and closed the side chapel and dispersed the crowds towards the square, there was a lot of people still waiting there. In the hour between the closing of the Sagrario and the transportation of the box to the cathedral next door, the square filled. And the mess at the cathedral started at 10 o'clock a.m. By then, the crowd of the square had acquired proportions rarely seen in Lima. They had brought banners with the names of their organizations, but also messages that emphasized Velasco's revolutionary character, his strong ties with the people. They sang political songs and popular music. They attempted to break the cordon several times again. And there are several testimonies saying that the people outside didn't hear anything of what was going on inside the chapel, but the people inside clearly could hear what was going on inside. When the mass was over at 11 o'clock a.m., the invitees started leaving the cathedral. The crowd booed and insulted the members of the government, starting with the revolutionary junta. Morales Bermúdez had not showed up following a specific request of the Velasco family. Still, he had not been forgotten, and people sang Morales al Cajón, Velasco a Palacio, Velasco a la Historia, Morales al Carajo. Then the coffin appeared, and the crowd roared, and the noise was as hard as the old square had ever witnessed. The bells tolled again, the national anthem was sung yet another time. The crowd tried once more to break the police defense, but they were successfully contained just like before, although this time the police used batons. Helicopters intimidatingly flew over the square. The multitude kept singing, in the shoulders of the people. Velasco is from the people, and he belongs to the people. The police and the military officers in charge had not. The protocol had to be followed. The coffin had to be carried in shoulders to the San Francisco Square, some 3 blocks from the plaza, but the names of those honored with the task had already been clearly established. Army officers, friends, representatives of organizations, for a total of 30 people, 6 at a time. And once in San Francisco, the coffin would be put inside the hearse, and a new cortege would leave for the cemetery of El Angel, some 5 kilometers away. And the burial would start at noon, only with invited people inside. The walk towards San Francisco through the old and narrow streets of the center of Lima proved slower and tougher than expected. The crowd by then was of at least 100,000. At a corner, after only 1 block, part of the crowd kept pushing the policemen and attempted to get to the coffin. The rest took the other street and ran towards San Francisco. When the coffin got there, the hearse was already waiting with the back door open. The members of the junta and other officials, friends, and the family were waiting in their cars. A group of about 100 people tried to intercept the coffin, but the mounted police managed to disperse them. But there was already too many people by then. The hearers had been surrounded, and in a few seconds the crowd consumed the police wall. The multitude swooped against the hearers, which still managed to move, but extremely slowly. It was a tremendously tense moment. Most of the members of the junta left their cars to seek refuge in one of the official buildings in the surroundings. People knelt in front of the car, tried to put nails in the tires, and generally did whatever they could to stop it. The car was now overheating and had to slow down even more. And suddenly, amidst the confusion, a mysterious character, there is a lot of speculation about who it was, managed to steal the keys from the driver through the window. At 10 past noon, the military officer in charge agreed with Velasco's family to allow the crowd to carry the coffin to the cemetery in their shoulders. It was about 5 kilometers to the Lancel Cemetery, mostly through the wide Avenida Bancay. The procession, about 250,000 at that point, moved extremely slowly. Some people stole flowers from the gardens and parks, put them on the coffin, others leant out their windows and balconies or stood in the sidewalks and cheered and threw confetti and pebbles. In the procession, people took short, early turns to carry Velasco in a group of 6, 7, or 8, depending on their size and strength. And they talked to the coffin. There's a lot of testimonies in the newspapers about that. It took 5 hours to get to Avenida Los Incas, where the cemetery was located. A police squad had been following the crowd all along, and a much larger one, this time armed with anti-riot gears and vehicles, waited for them. They were extremely aggressive and beat down a lot of people in a very short time. It became clear that the crowd was not going to be able to get into the cemetery. In a few minutes, the police had regained control over the coffin and had managed to bring it inside a cemetery. The crowd went back to singing. Velasco belongs to the people, not to the guerrillas. The people in uniform are also exploited. Only about 100 people from the whole crowd managed to enter the cemetery. Even some of the designated speakers were left out, particularly union leaders. Most of the invalids were there. Some people managed to climb the trees and the walls to watch the burial and listen to the speeches by Babareng, by representative of the family, and by members of the armed forces. Or looked through the old metallic grills of the cemetery walls, but most of them just stayed outside. At 15 past 4, a trumpet announced the beginning of a minute of silence, which meant that Velasco was being buried. Silence then interrupted by 21 cannon shots. This time, those outside had heard the noise from inside. Velasco was ultimately buried after an anti-riot operation by the military, but not in their own terms. In the process, a whole lot of people had managed to make their voices heard. So this is where the narrative part ends. And there are obviously a lot of ways in which these events can be interpreted, and I think this interpretive exercise cannot be distinguished from the narrative and from the contextualization. And I would love to hear advice on how to integrate all those things. And I clearly don't have enough time for a full exploration of all these avenues, but so I will just emphasize 3 main points that I think are the most coherent that I've come up with so far. One is the transitional, liminal character of the whole situation. From the liminal characteristics of ritual understood in terms of structural anthropology to the liminal characteristics of the revolution itself, understood as a transition, a transmission of power to the people, the transition between the first phase and the second phase of the revolution, and the initial steps to the transitions towards civilian democracy. Liminal moments, among which rituals are paradigmatic examples, are moments during which the existing order can be reshaped, even more so when direct symbols and even resources of power are displayed and contested. Second, forcing things a little bit, we could think about the liminality of massive social mobilization itself. The Peruvian Revolution had incentivized mobilization, but soon mobilization had acquired a dynamic of its own. And there was more than one point of collision between mobilization and control, manifested at times as attempts to turn mobilization into top-bottom directed participation, at times by the infiltration of the social movements, and at other moments by outright repression, even just between communist presence and McCarthyism, or the things that MLR is accused of being, but we have seen that's arguable. The juncture of the funeral was one of the most agitated moments of non-violent, organized, popular mobilization in the history of Peru. The process included a revitalized political sphere, revitalized by the first pre-electoral context in more than a decade, economic crisis, popular resistance to stabilization measures, massive protests and repression that had started under Velasco and were accentuated under Morales Bermúdez, and which included multi-party and urban-rural coalitions that came together in the most massive general strikes since 19, 19, massive looting and the complicity of the police, as in February 1975, the declaration of a year-long state of emergency, the establishment of draconian anti-union laws, and the general sense of betrayal by the government, made obvious by the provision to Morales Bermúdez's presence in the funeral, and the fact that people literally called for his head. Finally, I think all these things can be subsumed in a single point, illustrated by an interview given by Morales Bermúdez to Caretas, Peruvian magazine, several years later, in which he expressed his frustration about the huge adherence to the general strikes even after he had announced the return to democracy. So I think that in the context of social effervescence of this period during which the funeral was performed, the figure of Velasco, always crucial for articulating different political forces in the 1960s and 70s in Peru, could be used to represent a way to do politics based on the idea of transition, of the liminality of mobilization that had proved successful before us in the mass mobilizations, as opposed to the rigidity of military politics, but also to that of the formal democracy and economic orthodoxy that was being brought back. And if anything like Velasquismo as a political project existed, it was here for a short time in this confluence of social and political forces with leaders like Avelino Mar, Héctor Cornejo Chávez, or General Aníbal Mesa Cuadra, and with Velasco's figure as a conglomerating image, which considered mobilization as the political force. That day, mobilization was about controlling the liminal ritual, driving the revolution's heirs, and burying Velasco. Thank you.
So in this paper, I consider the collective memories elicited by the Velasco regime, a topic which has not received much scholarly attention. I approach these memories through an analysis of circa 1,500 comments attached to three video uploads on YouTube. As I showed in a previous study on collective memories of the War of the Pacific, an analysis of such comments provides useful insight into what Elizabeth Janine has called the labors of memory. YouTube video uploads, like many other digital artifacts, can function as online lieux de mémoire or websites of memory, not unlike more traditional sites of memory. However, because these online comments are interactive, either responses to the video recently viewed by the poster or to other comments, they operate as vehicles of memory or technologies of memory that help us explore the individual memory practices that are in turn expressive of collective memory practices. The comments to the video and the memories they reflect and mobilize, therefore, point to the current valence of the Velasco period. So I don't really have time to go into a description of the videos themselves, but suffice to say that one of the videos is quite favorable to Velasco, one is hostile, and the third one is non-committed. And the videos have been viewed by 350,000 people, so not all of them leave comments. There are only 1,500 comments, and many leave more than one comment. Still, I think it's a pretty large universe of comments that one can say provides some degree of insight into collective memories. So, the agrarian reform is one of the key issues that posters debate in the comments to the videos. Many posters view it as an unmitigated disaster that impacted negatively on agricultural productivity and economic growth and did nothing to address poverty in the countryside. So one commenter, for example, says, in response to Velasco's famous agrarian reform speech, "Sí, claro, muy lindo discurso, pura mierda. Lo único que han logrado es joder la productividad de todo el país." And he goes on in that mode. For many posters, the agrarian reform was doomed by the fact that it handed over land to people who did not know what to do with it. Mirko Jefe argues, for example, that Velasco no hizo nada más que manobrar la economía del Perú de esa época. Mismo del campesino, ¿cómo le vas a dar tierras a alguien que no tiene cómo sembrarlas? This is a comment that comes back over and over again. However, the agrarian reform is remembered not only because of its impact on rural Peru, agricultural productivity, or the well-being of the peasantry. It is also remembered because of its broader impact on Peruvian society. And in particular, a number of posters view the impact of the agrarian reform in terms of its supposed consequences for the social and racial makeup of Lima. They argue that the agrarian reform contributed to the wave of migration from the highlands to the capital and, as a consequence, radically transformed what was until then, according to them, a largely criollo or white city. For example, one poster suggests that Velasco was responsible for the fact that many peasants who benefited from the agrarian reform lost their lands because they did not know how to manage them. Y que por consecuencia, this is emigraron a la capital, causando una sobrepoblación. No digo que esté mal que emigren, pero sí tal vez el general Velasco hubiese tomado una mejor decisión, no habría tantos sectores pobres en Lima, en su mayoría emigrantes. And this same argument is made in overtly racist ways in a number of cases, and I'll skip those, but they're in the paper. For many more people, however, the agrarian reform amounted to an emancipation of Peru's peasant and indigenous population. The term esclavitud, slavery, is used frequently by those who make this point. Although many agreed that the agrarian reform was not a resounding success, it was first and foremost a process that gave many Peruvians their freedom, or put differently, that made them citizens. So one poster says, es cierto que la reforma agraria falló, pero fue un logro social, los campesinos ya no fueron esclavos. Another says, a pesar de que la reforma agraria no haya sido un triunfo como se había planificado, y que ahora los gamonalcillos y los privilegiados hacen leña y culpan de todos los males del Perú al chino Velasco, fue la liberación ideológica de los oprimidos. And there's more of this, and the other term that comes up a lot is dignidad, dignity. As many of these comments indicate, memories of the Velasco regime are highly focused on Velasco and as an individual. Velasco, rather than the regime or the intellectual architect of the regime, is identified as the source or originator of important reforms such as the agrarian reform or initiatives such as Peru's military rearmament. So you get lots of comments like, el único presidente de clase mundial que tuvo el Perú. He's frequently compared to other great leaders such as Ramón Castilla, Cáceres, and occasionally Tupac Amaru. By contrast, posters often accuse Morales Bermúdez of being a traitor. Someone said, Velasco fue el mejor presidente del Perú. Quien lo fregó todo fue Morales Bermúdez que se vendió. Almost invariably, the idea that Velasco was a great leader is conveyed through two statements that invoke heteronormativity and high masculinity. Velasco, they claim, had huevos and wore pantalones. And these two terms come back over and over again. So, for example, David Loaiza says, es el único presidente que tuvo los huevos de enfrentar el capitalismo. Another says, Velasco fue el único presidente que ha tenido pantalones para enfrentarse a los gringos. This highly gendered language, with its reference both to the male genitals and the trousers, is of course expressive of the ways in which leadership is associated, in Peru and indeed elsewhere with male and indeed hyper-masculine characteristics. It also suggests, perhaps less directly, a perception of Velasco as a father figure who could engender a new generation of Peruvians. By contrast, Morales Bermúdez is, in addition to being branded a traitor, is often called both a maricón and a puto. He is presented in this way as a man of, at best, suspect masculinity. Through these comments about his leadership and hyper-masculine qualities, Velasco is presented as a sort of ubermensch. And this characteristic is retained in discussions that assess the failure of the reforms, because typically the blame for the failure of the reforms is shifted away from Velasco to other operators. And to conclude this section, the argument I make at the end is that this shifting away of blame from Velasco to others, both by those who support Velasco and by those who oppose him. Those who oppose him typically say that he handed over land to people who didn't know what to do with it. I think expresses quite well the way in which this dominant idea in Peru of the indigenous not being able to do anything that is productive permeates discussions about Velasco as well. So I want to talk a little bit about the other themes that come through. Beyond the agrarian reform, a number of themes come through. One of these is the idea that Velasco did not die because of complications following the aneurysm he suffered in 1973, but rather that he was assassinated. And typically, posters argue that the United States, and sometimes more specifically the CIA, often in collaboration with the Chilean government, was responsible for Velasco's death. Now, the idea that Velasco did not die from ill health but was assassinated is consistent with the idea that he was an ubermensch. A man with his huevos and who wore pantalones the way he did could not have been defeated by a simple disease. He had to be killed. Moreover, he had to have been killed by an overwhelming force. that this force was the United States is logical, not only because the US was the most overwhelming force around, but also because, and this is something that many posters stress, Velasco challenged and indeed undermined US imperialism. So one poster, for example, uses those very terms. Ese golpe y la toma de la IPC fue un golpe al imperio. Y ese es un acto transcendental. Lo demostramos a Sudamérica que no le teníamos al gobierno, teníamos al gobierno de Estados Unidos y a todos sus agentes, CIA, y hay que tener huevos para eso. These and many other comments and the ubiquity of references to soberanía, sovereignty, suggest that for many posters, Velasco represents a moment when this happened with peasants, with the agrarian reform, Peru as a nation state gained a degree of freedom. This notion of freedom or independence is expressed in several comments and focus on the extent to which Velasco's economic reforms sought to reduce the dependency of the Peruvian economy and in particular reduce the economy's reliance on primary export. And the counterpart to this is the idea that in addition to doing this, Velasco also promoted industry and in so doing gave the Peruvian economy far more to stand on. It is in comments that refer to Peru's relations with Chile that Velasco's role as a leader and as an ubermensch capable of almost single-handedly increasing Peru's standing in the world is expressed more clearly in the comments. According to many posters, under Velasco, other countries in Latin America, and particularly Chile, began to respect Peru. Juan Velasco le devolvió la dignidad al Perú y a los peruanos. En Sudamérica todos nos respetaban, y Chile tenía a Velasco. Pero ahora se burlan de nosotros y hacen lo que quieren con nuestra patria. For many posters, the real reason that Velasco was removed from power was that he planned to attack Chile and regain the provinces lost to Chile in the War of the Pacific. This planned war did not sit well with the United States. This one poster says, Ya estaba todo listo para reventar esos chilenos de mierda y recuperar Arica, pero un golpe de Estado con Bermúdez apoyado por los Estados Unidos la cagó. Another says, Así se habla, carajo. Cueste lo que cueste, recuperaremos lo nuestro. Arica y Tarapacá volverán a ser peruanos. Nuestro general Velasco lo tenía bien planeado, pero estaba rodeado de traidores, quienes acabaron con él. Pero jamás con sus ideales, que solo los patriotas lo haremos cumplir, tarde o temprano. Vive el Perú, carajo. The final important question that mobilizes memories of the Velasco government is the relation between the reforms implemented during the military regime and the rise of Shining Path. And here, opinions again are divided. Several posters argue that the regime's reforms, and more specifically, the agrarian reform weakened the impact of the Shining Path insurgency. One poster suggests that thanks to the agrarian reform, the peasantry who gained ownership of the land felt that they had something to lose from backing Shining Path. As a consequence, a potential civil war was averted. By contrast, others argue that by aligning himself with socialism, Velasco basically gave socialism traction in Peru, and this opened the ground for Shining Path. These divergent interpretations of the links between the Velasco regime and the rise of Shining Path reflect, though they do not neatly map onto, different ways in which the internal armed conflict is itself remembered. Although some posters reproduce the idea that violence was intrinsic to left-wing ideologies shared by Velasco and Shining Path, the extent to which the agrarian reform weakened or sharpened those inequalities and therefore increased or decreased the likelihood of violence is ultimately the main question that different posters return to in order to assess the link between Velasco and the internal armed conflict. In this way, memories of the Velasco regime and memories of the internal armed conflict are mobilized in a way that so as to explain the other process. So to conclude, the past is the past, but how we make sense of the past, what sense the past has, is always subject to change. Individuals and groups remember and forget the past selectively. They mobilize specific memories for particular purposes. The video producers are memory entrepreneurs. They seek to mobilize through their YouTube videos, particularly memories of the Velasco regime, memories that were intended to shape both how the past is remembered but also how the present is interpreted. They also seek to shape expectations of the future. But the posters of comments on the videos are also memory entrepreneurs. Through their interventions in the debates that the videos enable and promote, they too attempt to influence how the past is remembered and how the present and future are envisioned. The negative memories of the Velasco regime serve to mobilize first and foremost a critique of statism and by extension of the left. They are a critique of the critique of neoliberalism. Velasco is a lesson to be learned, an experiment never to be repeated. Velasco, these mobilized memories suggest, is an example of in the past or the future in which the current model of development in Peru is altered. In some ways, these negative memories of Velasco are a particularly Peruvian version of the injunction that came to characterize post-dictatorship processes in the Southern Cone, nunca más. In Peru, however, nunca más refers not to dictatorship or human rights abuses, but to state-led development. The more positive memories of the Velasco regime point to what many see as the key issue that Peruvians face today, the key issues. Several posters express nostalgia for a period when military order reigned. So one of them, for example, remembers the time, the military regime as a time when political corruption did not exist. ¿Cuánta falta hace eso, aquellos soldados que libraron de las cuánto abuso de politiqueros corruptos? Los milicos de hoy en día son una tarea de cobardes, miedosos, mediocres, de patria, están al servicio politiquero. Others remember the military regime as a time when military service instilled proper values in the young. Ya no hay servicio militar obligatorio, como consecuencia de eso hay rateros, drogadictos, prostitución en las calles, hijos matan a sus padres o violan a sus madres, ahora matar se hizo común, el pandillaje. But more generally, as I have shown, the positive memories of the Velasco period are associated with terms like dignity, sovereignty, economic and political independence, huevos, and pantalones. These terms express, arguably, collective aspirations, not only for order, but also for social justice, social equity, a sense of community, and the hope that Peru can gain a more elevated position in the world, not least vis-a-vis Chile. Although he did not succeed, many believe that this is what Velasco strove for. This is why, almost half a century after the coup of 1968, many Peruvians remember Velasco fondly.
Thank you. Thank you to all three.
Thank you, everybody. I have a question for all three. Well, question for all three. Carlos, I was wondering about 1974. I did some grad work in about 1924, and that was almost as big a celebration as 1921 was, celebrating Ayacucho. And I was wondering if there's anything planned for that, and whether the Instituto Bolivariano existed, and whether they had anything to say. Adrian is wondering about, I really like your description of the funeral, and it reminded me of, and I think the setting helps, Princess Diana, and perhaps the poet, fervor over her untimely death, but what death is ever timely, and maybe there's a relationship there. And then for Pablo, I was wondering, thinking about my training in oral history theory, and how oral history is, what about the past, but also about the present. So do you think that this is, these comments on Velasco are a commentary on maybe Humala or Garcia, the package depends when the comments are made, and how Humala comes into power with apparently very revolutionary-like discourse, yet has not fulfilled that revolutionary-like discourse?
First of all, I'm not a historian, I don't have a background in history, I'm coming from a cultural studies, critical theory sort of perspective, particularly psychoanalysis and post-colonial theory. One of the things that I find particularly interesting in the interpretation of those years of Velasco's government is this idea of nationalism and how nationalism was reinforced. But I think another thing that you touch upon is this notion of nostalgia. Okay, and melancholy, in the sense of previous movements, like for instance, you can go back as far as the Tacoronco, for instance, in Mohammed, when, you know, there is this idea of trying to rejuvenate a whole country, you know, trying to establish a new model that will bring social justice to those people who haven't, you know, who have been put aside from all these development projects. And it seems to me that this is a recurring theme in Peruvian history, you know, with the Tacoronco, with Velasco. I'm trying to think to what extent amongst Peruvians at the time, and even today, there is this idea that there is going to be a time when things are going to be different and things are going to change radically. And that collective imagination is, in fact, sort of pushing certain ideologies within Peruvian society. That's why I disagree with this idea of a sort of Velasquismo here for a short time. I don't think Velasquismo is here for a short time. I think Velasquismo is just an expression of a recurring thing going on in Peru since the time of you know, colonization. So I suppose it's just a reflection on that, and to what extent perhaps do you think nostalgia in those terms is also part of you know, that project that you know a large number of Peruvians wanted to achieve, or want to achieve, but it seems that it's always negated to them. You know, it's never delivered, you know, to the point where actually that change happens.
Untimely death is sadly, has historically been very much a feature of political life in Latin America. I'm older than most people here. And regrettably, I've known 31 people who've died before their time. Admittedly, a goodly chunk of those were involved in the guerrilla of Teoponte in Bolivia. But still, if you contrast that with the fact that I don't know any European who has been assassinated or died because of some political motivation, there are different ways in which accusations of this arise. Sometimes, where it's not clearly the case, it can be a long time afterwards, as in the case of Frey in Chile, which is now being investigated, or it can be virtually instantaneous, as in the case a year ago of the death of Osvaldo Paya in Cuba, where this was simply not accepted as being the accident that the Cuban regime said it was. In the case of Vasco, which more closely typifies, how quickly did the rumors that he'd been done to death by La Silla, the Chileans, whoever, how quickly did that follow his death? And what were the ways in which this surfaced?
Why don't we start there and then we can have a second round.
Well, my answer would be very short because, partly because I haven't, you know, read the newspapers of that year yet. And also because I think the commemorations were, you know, much less prominent than the sesquicentennial of the Proclamation of Independence, 1974. You know, there was not nearly as much events and rituals and all that as 1971. So that's my impression, but again, I haven't finished reviewing the newspapers for that year.
So thank you for the questions and comments. So to Nathan's question, I don't know much about Princess Diana, but one thing, a couple of things that come to mind is one thing that I mentioned a little bit before is this idea of martyrdom. As there's this book by Laman Johnson, this compilation of essays about death, prominent death people in Latin America. And he insists on the idea that for some reason in Latin America, the most, the funerals or the dead bodies that have more impact are those of people that have lost or that are considered martyrs of some kind. And the second thing, and I think Velasco's, in the case of during the Morales Bermúdez government, could certainly be considered as a defeated a man, as a defeated revolution, etc. So that's one possibility. And the second idea is this, that maybe Princess Diana had in common with Velasco, I don't know that there's many others, other things, but it's this idea that a person that put an institution that was traditionally or historically separated from the population in contact with the population. And so there's a sort of a tribute or homage or recognition of that. That's another possibility. And about the idea of nostalgia and melancholy, I think it's a very provocative way to think about Peruvian history in that way in the long term, and buscando un Inca is perhaps an expression of that. at the same time, I am a historian, and I would think about exploring these different moments of, the, without disagreeing that there might be a permanent long duress sort of nostalgia around, I would be careful about thinking, for instance, about Taquionco as a nostalgic thing. There's a lot of ways to interpret Taquionco in its own context, about very specific material issues in that moment, or political issues about the moment, about the encomiendas, etc. So I don't know if we could use the same logic to the whole of Peruvian history, more or less, or after the colonial period at least. And in any case, even if this worked in a long-term historical interpretation, I think if Velasquismo, Velasquismo was a short-term political thing after Velasco, nostalgia could have been there for 500 years, but the fact is that nobody else used Velasquismo afterwards. More or less, so nostalgia didn't manifest itself as Velasquismo, it disappeared as a political tool for an amount of reasons, until very recently. In fact, there was a recent attempt to do a political party reclaiming the name of Velasco, etc. But so there might be some larger thing behind, but I would stick to my claim that Velasquismo was a very short-lived attempt of a political movement, if there ever was one, actually, because this was a very specific thing, I think.
So the question about how quickly the rumors about his assassination formulated, I don't know, to be honest. I need to look into this. But certainly in the material that I've looked, it's pretty widespread. I mean, it's kind of taken for granted that he was assassinated. But it's a good question. I need to trace when this starts to emerge. On nostalgia, I agree with Adrian in the sense that I don't think one can really talk about this ever present nostalgia for something, and in a sense, I don't think that is particularly Peruvian. I mean, you know, about Brazil, they always say Brazil is the country of tomorrow and will always be. So that kind of sense of unfulfilled potential is found elsewhere. Contrary to what you said, I do think that Velasquismo kind of continues to exist, not qua Velasquismo, but you know, in what Velasquismo is thought to represent. And so I think the memories about Velasco that I've kind of looked at point to an aspiration, a desire for many of the elements that are understood to be part of the Velasquista package to be reintroduced as part of a political and social and economic project. So in that respect, that what Velasquismo means is still very much present. And yes, I mean, these videos, two of the videos were uploaded during the run up to the first round of the 2011 elections. So clearly they were part, one of the videos was a demolition job on Humala, because it was trying to, you know, tar Humala by association with Velasco, and the other one was trying to do the opposite, it was trying to, you know, bolster Humala by associating him with Velasco. So, you know, so clearly, yes, Humala's invocation of, you know, kind of military reformism, if you like, in an earlier Humala version, is part of this.
Can I add something I forgot? Carlos just reminded me that I made a mistake. There was a more of a Velasquista attempt in a way of using directly Velasco's name. It was the Partido Socialista Revolucionario right after this moment, actually, which actually won some seats in the Constitutional Assembly, etc., led by Leonidas Rodríguez Figueroa, which was this military that was the boss of Sinamos during its most radical periods. So, just wanted to mention that.
Have time for a second now?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I very much enjoyed this debate, and I wanted to, one of the questions, make a comment to Adrian's paper, because What is particularly interesting about Velasco's funeral is that it was a military funeral. So military funerals have like a different, sort of a different structure. So that is what makes this event much more transgressive, because the person has to be with a uniform, and there needs to be some kind of special music, and the family receives, you know, the hat. I mean, there is this whole protocol that needs to be followed. So that is what makes, and actually, it could not, I mean, parts of that ritual were fulfilled, but basically much of that was not controlled by the army. So I think that is so fascinating about this specific liminal moment, as you label it. And I was thinking, not necessarily about Lady's funeral, but when I was reading your paper, I was thinking about a more contemporary political person for the history of Peru. And I was thinking about Ollanta, for example. When President Ollanta died, there were thousands and thousands of people going to the cemetery. I think it was in the north of Lima, to an extent that actually it was the people who were reclaiming the right to follow Ollanta to his last house. So I was thinking that probably you cannot think of more opposite images, Ollanta and Velasco, but actually it's the people's desire to express that connection with a political leader. I mean, such two different people, I mean, Velasco and Ollanta. So I was just thinking about the liminality of these moments, in which what is what makes people express this desire to appropriate these political figures at some point. I was thinking about the characteristics of a military funeral, and on the case of Velasco, and then thinking about more contemporary example of the Ollanta, and I don't know, I mean, probably this is what we are going to see with Fujimori. With Fujimori, I mean, yes, I mean, probably this is what are going to see. I mean, and when I was thinking about binomio, you know, the binomio Pueblo Fuerza Armada, the funeral is basically of Velasco, that's the embodiment, it's the people reclaiming Velasco's rights. So I thought it was a very powerful and progressive.
I'm almost rethinking this question, so if it becomes too obscure, ignore it. But I was also wondering, I mean, we're talking about a lot about memory and connections, and I was just wondering, you know, you were talking about very clear connections of Tupac Amaru and looking back, but over the course of your research, have you found, like, maybe secondary or more minor connections that surprised you? For example, you know, thinking of like the nunca mas of statism. You know, after, for example, the fall of the Bustamante Rivero government, there was a sentiment in Peru of, well, we're not doing that again, you know, in the 1950s, when you had this return to orthodox liberalism. Have you seen kind of more minor comparisons to fallen leaders or military leaders or statism governments over your research that kind of were surprising or not dominant, but a little bit more under the surface? I hope that clear, but it might not be.
I would like to appoint that, or maybe have you thought what are the implications, where are the implications of the Velasquism, the relation with the development of liberation theology and the NRPA, Revolutionary Movement, Tupac Amaru, and all that generation is not just in terms of history, but what they have to live. How that impressed them to change society and to the development of our society. And also, it didn't stop just there, because also we have the words of Zimmerman, I think it's Augusto Zimmerman with the Corsacin Peru magazine, who lasted almost 90s before he was, not happy for that. I don't think it's just a melancholy, I don't think it's just last a period of time, and it's just forgotten. It might be forgotten by the historians, it might be forgotten by the system, but not for the real people that took from there to start with a new modern society.
There were three more questions
that
I think
about
that.
I really enjoyed the papers, thank you very much. Just a reflection for Adrian and Paulo, it's very interesting to see how there's such a movement from the moment when Velasco is interred to present day and readings from the present. It's also interesting to me if there's any, obviously very difficult to see how people who actually lived the Velasco period remember the Velasco period, as opposed to people who haven't lived it and have a very strong set of ideas about what happened there, either very positive or very negative. So I find that very interesting, especially with work of memory of the past and how things have changed. And for Carlos, I had a bit more of a comment than a question. It's very interesting to me, not surprising at all, that Velasco would have aligned with a more conservative nation fighting for its freedom discourse when thinking about the 60th centenario. Interesting as well, the images that you show, the Tupac Amaru here that the officials choose, there's the Quaker hat style one, whereas that one, whereas the Comercio one, which was in your previous slide, is the revolutionary man with the bit of flying hair. So it's interesting how Tupac Amaru becomes very so central in propaganda, in history, but very problematic, particularly for the more conservative side of the academy that is in charge of this amazing project. And the fact that the military chose such an academic project as a celebration, I think is also interesting. And maybe it does go back to what someone mentioned earlier, I think it was with this, the training from Guy and this very nationalist rhetoric and that had been built in Velasco's thinking. And just briefly on the celebration in Ayacucho, let's not forget that the monument that they set up in La Pampa de la Quinua has 44 floors representing every year from Tupac Amaru until the Battle of Ayacucho, because this was understood to be the struggle. The struggle was from Tupac Amaru to Ayacucho, and that was kind of the closing of a long season. For the celebrations in 2024.
A lot of my questions are either been answered or picking up on other comments that people have made. But for Adrian, I was thinking also about how much of the rallying there, the people and everybody turning out, is just something that's human nature that they might have done anyways, versus it being about his politics in particular. And I think that Lorne's example was great on that point already. So I think that just solidified what I was going to ask about there. Carlos, I was thinking about your paper and Stefano's really made me think about the relationship between the historiography and the state of scholarship and what Velasco is doing. And I don't hear about that with politics that often. Like right now in the United States, we never hear about the relationship between historiography and the Tea Party. But you know what I mean? It's completely, what's that?
They've taken out slavery out of Texas schools.
Right, because they're going against it, right. But you're both talking about where the scholarship is and how policies are or are not reflective of that. I'm just wondering about whether Velasco is unique on that, whether Peru is unique on that, what your sense is for that connection between historiography and Velasco's policies. And then Paulo, I was thinking, you concluded really focusing on the state and statism. But I was wondering, I'm sure this is too simplistic, but it almost seemed like people who are critical had an economic lens and people who were supportive had a social lens. And does it break down like that, or it's so hard to make it's too simplistic. And I guess one methodological question I had for you, did you think about quantifying ever your comments? You showed such a great range of them that in a critical way we could say you could make them say whatever you wanted. But that's not what you're trying to do either. But I'm just wondering about methodologically, and you've explained some of it.
Well, the commentary about history, historiography, memory. I was always surprised that Juan Santos Atahualpa was never picked up by my colleagues in Sinamos. And I insisted. This point may come in politics, because Juan Santos was really a traitor of Andean culture that decided to go and work with business people of the Amazon, and the country and the revolutionary movement was not ready to accept. I have been invited now to Peru, together with Ashaninka, to to go before the Congress and present the case of Ashanika and Juan Santos. This is a confidential information that I'm divulging. As one of the ambassadors of the independence of Peru. Because the Ashanika and the Yanish and Juan Santos fought in 1748 for the independence of Peru. Actually, it was in alliance with the British, trying to bring the British into that. Okay, that's one question. The other thing, the other observation is about the conception of time. In the Andean world and in the indigenous world, time is perceived as a cyclical, circular process. So the idea of nostalgia is linked to Inkari and the idea of the return. If you have a cyclical conception, not a linear ascending conception of time, which is Judeo-Christian Mediterranean, then it is always possible the return to the cosmogonic time, to the origin. And the eschatology, the final, the end of time is also the beginning of the new cycle. And in that, I think that Argueda was much more understanding without being an historiographer, because Argueda is the one that brought to the Peruvian people the idea of Inkari, the ideology of Inkari, the return and of the dismembered body of the Inca. There is a fantastic sentence that Argueda quotes from a peasant in Ayacucho. Argueda asked him in Quechua, "What is Inca?" And the answer of the translating into Spanish, the answer of the peasant, illiterate Quechua speaker peasant, indigenous person, was Inca is the beginning and the support of everything that exists in the world. Inca is not the historical formation of a Cuspeño class that decided to build a state. It's something more philosophical, more ontological. So I think that when, for historians, to think in the history of indigenous people is a challenge to get rid of some of the historiographic paradigm that we have been trained to think with. That's just a commentary from the old retired professor.
Yeah, well, before I answer some of the questions, I also have my own question. Actually, a couple of comments, questions for Paulo. Before that, I also want to mention that all these conspiracy theories about Velasco and the CIA started way, way before his death. I remember the Cinco de Febrero riots were also, you know, linked to CIA conspiracy. And I remember, the slogans that said APRA y la CIA la misma porquería.
Yes,
that's,
yes,
you know,
yes.
You know, militants, members.
Ultra
is here. Oh, APRA, thank you, yes. Yeah, so, you know, it's all of these, and the CIA was always there as part of the rhetoric, as the enemy. And so I wanted to highlight that. And for Paulo, first of all, who are these commentators, these, you know, users that are leaving comments? My guess, I'm not in the social network world, but I'm guessing mostly young people. Maybe wrong, but probably. And so this, although this is a large universe, it's a large universe within a very constrained sub-universe of watchers, readers, and commentators. So I think that needs to be taken into account. And then second, some of the comments reflect what I would call an authoritarian positive view of Velasco. It's like, you know, that's what we need, right? I mean, and I have heard this over and over again in Peru. We need somebody with huevos, but, you know, it's not just courageous, but also a strong hand, which sometimes translates into we need a Pinochet, right? Somebody that puts order. And so, you know, the positive views of Velasco can also complicate this by bringing back authoritarian solutions to social problems. On the question of Velasquismo and liberation theology, I skipped a couple pages that I referred to that, and I'm going to read just briefly the the Episcopado Peruano issued a statement on the sesquicentennial that is really very telling. And it says, La Iglesia Católica, al participar del regocijo y de la esperanza que despierta esta conmemoración, quiere poner en luz el mensaje evangélico de la liberación para interpretar el profundo sentimiento de la libertad. La jura de la independencia significó cambio político. Sin embargo, en su entraña encierra el profundo anhelo de la liberación general, exenta de trabas externas para responder a las exigencias de libertad y justicia que el Perú reclama hoy dentro de un proceso de cambio. I mean, you cannot get more Velasquista than this, right? The, you know, the bishops in Bagarén was key here. Not everybody, but you know, there were also these groups, this group called the Oscura Rojos, right? I can't remember now the name of this group, that NC, or I mean, there was a siglas ahí. It was a group of priests that were called Oscura Rojos in the Velasco period. So, definitely many intellectual members of the Velasco administration were influenced by liberation theology, and many members of the Catholic Church expressed support for many of the reforms that Velasco implemented, as this statement shows. Natalia's point about this image of Tupac Amaru and the other one that is actually shows what could be seen as a real human, although obviously out of proportion, etc. But this highlights the point I was trying to make, that for Velasco, Tupac Amaru was a logo and an image that they put everywhere: posters, records, books, pamphlets, banners, demonstrations, and so forth. And it was like with the Che Guevara famous picture. This is flat; it's two dimensional, right? It's completely ahistorical, right? But it serves the political purpose, and that's what Velasco was mostly interested in, along with the people in charge of doing the publicity, including Jesús Ruiz Durán, the author of the logo and of many of the posters. I interviewed him just a few weeks ago, and he said, "You know how I made it? One day they called me and said, we need to print 100,000 copies of this poster. We need a logo." And he said, yeah, Tupac Amaru. And then they started, brainstorming, then they came with the Tupac Amaru idea. And he did it, he told me, because he remembered an old textbook in which somebody had included an image, a supposed image of Tupac Amaru. And they came up with this, just remember the hat, and then he drew the hat. And of course, there are also speculations. This may be more kind of implicit or unconscious, but there are also speculations that what he did was he drew a T and an A, like Tupac Amaru. So you can see the T and then the A, and he came up with this logo. But anyway, the use of Velasco, the use by Velasco of the liturgy of Tupac Amaru was obviously much more political than is historiographical. And another thing that I skip is that in the commission work, yes, there are several volumes devoted to Tupac Amaru and the rebellion, but the very first multi-volume set is to the Precursores Ideológicos, right? Then comes Tupac Amaru. So you see the priority even then. And there are more volumes devoted to the mostly Creole Precursores Ideológicos than to Tupac Amaru. Right, what I showed about the images of the supplements reinforces that. Finally, I think Mark's question about historiography and politics. Yeah, there are other cases. I don't think this is just in Peru, but there are sort of eruptions of themes and subjects that almost, impose themselves as historical subjects. For instance, the centennial of the War of the Pacific. Right? I mean, everybody started, not everybody, but a lot of people started writing and doing research about that, and you know, some important work came out of that, Nelson Manrique, and you know, Florencia Mallon, and all this. You know, it's not a coincidence. And then, of course, when the Shining Path guerrillas started, I mean, there was a wave of studies on violence. I mean, the number of titles on violence in Peru, in Peruvian history, you know, exploded. There are many other examples, I'm sure, in other countries as well. So I think there are these moments that almost make it necessary to explore in historical terms, and then you know, scholars you know, follow up on that. So I think that's all I need to say.
So yeah, that last point, just I wanted to say a very short thing, and that your paper reminded me of, which is that a lot of these guys that were on the committee, let's see, there were my professors still at the Universidad Católica, and that probably also explains a lot of the, I mean, the amount of things that there are that have not been treated in Peruvian history is amazing, and that it's reflected in some of these comments in YouTube also. So a lot of those comments, I think, are related. I think that Lourdes' comment, this sort of the structure of military funeral is a great point that I don't know much about, to be honest. What's the protocol? What was specific in this case about it being a military protocol? What is clear is that it was challenging. It was challenging the military that were in charge. That's as much I can say. The other thing is that it also was a state funeral, and it also a president of the republic, which has its own characteristics, and it of course was also a Catholic funeral. But it was a Catholic funeral led by Babarén, which makes it much more complicated. So there's people getting into the cathedral without permission. There were people that slept in the cathedral the night before. So it's a very complicated thing, and I would have to explore a lot of things about a lot of different rituals to understand it fully, and I don't know that I can do that. This is not my main research project at the moment, although it would be a nice one. But it's a great point. On the idea of the similarity with Belaunde's funeral, which I think is connected with Marx's point about human nature, and this with Stefan's point in a different way, I think what I see as the peculiarity here is that it was defying a military authoritarian dictatorship that had explicitly prohibited people from doing that, and that had already shown that it was going, that it would exert repression at a large scale. And we can attribute the presence of people there for an amount of reasons. And in my paper, I mentioned things like it was Christmas, it was holidays, that allowed a lot of people to go. It was summer, so people don't mind being outside for a while, etc. But for people to defy a military dictatorship, put themselves in risk, I would think about the political context as an important determinant. And I would think that requires some sort of organization too. And there's, in the paper I also mentioned a couple of the people that sings and that intervene in different ways. There's a couple of mentions of the Velasco, the Peruvian Inca, and things like that. But I wouldn't attribute, with the knowledge I have of this for now, I don't really know who all these people were. I don't know that there was political organizations involved. I wouldn't know that I would attribute the whole thing to Andean vision. For some people, there's evidence. It's hard to say to what degree. Regarding the Belaunde comparison, one thing I was forgetting is I mean, there's this thing about people wanting to participate in a situation like this, which is, we can call it human nature. But the Belaunde funeral, I think, had its own political context too. It was El Demócrata Belaunde, right? After the Fujimori dictatorship. So there were, after a government by Paniagua, which was the same party as Belaunde. So it can be a redemption of Acción Popular in some way, or this sort of democratic spring in Peru. So I think it would be interesting to explore Belaunde, but to do a more thorough comparison. And as for, I thought that was, I mean, it made me think about my paper, a comment about theology of liberation and Zimmerman and all that stuff, about this continuity of Velasco. And I want to make sure that I mean, I'm not claiming at all that the idea of, like, everybody forgot about Velasco completely. Velasco is still in culture, in politics, in different ways, but there's not a party called the Velasquista Party, and there's nobody really saying that they're going to do what Velasco is going to do, probably until Humala, like the previous Humala. So I think, I mean, it has certainly lost political appeal for a couple of decades at least, just as the whole of the Peruvian left because of the Shining Path and the neoliberalism, etc. But Velasquismo explicitly at least has. I think that's pretty clear.
Okay, well, several questions sort of related to methodology. I'm kind of convinced by the approach, but you can see how others might not be. I guess one way to think about it is that these comments are a bit like an open archive, right? So, yes, you could quantify, and you'd be able to find, you know, more precise correlation between particular points of view and how many people have that point of view. But because it's an open archive, unlike other archives which are, you know, are difficult to access, by simply clicking on the link in the footnote, you can actually go and see the same comments that I've kind of selected. So I guess that, for me, that's sort of transparency, which in fact it goes far beyond the transparency with sources that you normally get in other types, with other types of sources. So that gives me the confidence to say I am not selecting or making points that are not can't be backed up by the archive. The archive is there, you can view it. So that would be one way to answer that point. About the different memories of people who lived through that period and those who didn't. I mean, this is very difficult to get at because, yes, I mean, most of the comments are, the only thing you know about, you can tell something about the poster if they tell you something about themselves, and sometimes that happens. So for example, in the paper, there's a little discussion of post-memory, i.e., you know, those who say, I know this because my father told me. So it's a kind of transmitted memory. And then, and in memory studies, there are all these kind of terms that one can use to talk about different types of memories, and in some cases have to do with that. But in most cases, you don't know who these people are. And you know, sometimes their tags tell you something about who they are, but most of the time they don't. So in some ways, I know there are people behind these comments, but they're also, to some extent, you know, free-floating texts. So there's that problem. But of course, a different methodology, a more kind of conventional, traditional oral history, could be, you know, used to look at, you know, what someone who lived through the Velasco years remembers about that period, and compare that to, you know, young people who just have an indirect memory. So that could certainly be done, but that wasn't what I was trying to do here. Whether, you know, because these are sort of social media, all the commentators are young, I'm not too sure about that. I mean, I think, yes, I mean, likely there is an over-representation of young people, but I don't think, you know, it's just young people. And in fact, a lot of these views, I mean, I think the reason why I'm confident in saying these are views that I find here that I think are also around more generally is that I think you'd agree that a lot of these views are also present in
newspapers and other media. So they're expressed in this particular medium in a very extreme way. But the kernel of the idea in each comment is I think present in Peruvian society. And then the point about which you raised, Carlos, about the fact that in some of the positive perceptions of Velasco there is a troubling authoritarian view of Peru. I mean, I think they're positive only in the sense that they have a positive recollection of Velasco. I don't think they're positive in, I mean, I'm not attaching a value judgment to they are what they are. I'm not saying that I agree with them or that I think that we should agree with them. But you're absolutely right. There is a nostalgia, perhaps is the right word, for Manoluda. And in fact, there's one comment in the written paper where Velasco is remembered in with Fujimori. And they're both appreciated for having been, strong men. So
the chinos.
and the chinos. And then one last point, which to go back to Mark about whether the negative comments focus on the economy and the positive comments focus on the social. I think that's broadly right, with one caveat, which is that the negative comments also focus on race a lot. This idea that Velasco screwed everything up because he allowed the Cholos to come to Lima, just come back over and over again. So it's a very racialized comment. And in some ways, you could argue that the economic argument itself is highly racialized because of what the type of economy which the reforms create.
So we arrive at 4:30, so...